What a treat to have David Breckner with us today. He's one of those chapel speakers we have every other year. I think he's about the only one other than Dr. Billy Kim who comes often to speak with us, because David's messages are always so powerful and helpful to our campus. He serves as president of Jews for Jesus in San Francisco and was scheduled to come and speak this spring, but obviously can't do that because of COVID. So I'm so glad he could share through video. I deeply appreciate David. I always am enriched by my time with him. He's been a great friend through the years. His leadership of Jews for Jesus is just enormous, and how God has used him and those who work alongside him. And I know his message will be of help to you today.
A hearty shalom to all my friends and the Belhaven University family there in Jackson or wherever you may be. I'm David Breckner, Executive Director of Jews for Jesus, coming to you from San Francisco, California. And this is not my first time being with you, but I look forward to the next time when hopefully we'll be face to face. In the meantime, we are grateful for the virtual opportunity, and thank you, Dr. Parrott, for inviting me and Jews for Jesus to be a part of the chapel there at Belhaven. You know, we've been coming through an amazing time, haven't we, of pandemic. And so I'm especially grateful that you have chosen such a wonderful verse from the Psalms. Light dawns in the darkness for the godly. They are generous, compassionate, and righteous. And we certainly in Jews for Jesus have seen light dawning in this dark time of COVID-19. In fact, as we measure our effectiveness over this past year, and it's been a year now, we had more engagements, more opportunity to minister to unbelieving Jewish people in 2020 than we had in 2019. And God opened doors of opportunity for us. For example, in Israel, where there is a food truck that we have, we were contacted by the Israeli government asking us to pick up the slack where certain food banks had closed, that we were given actually names and addresses of shut-ins to go and to bring food to. And so I never thought I'd live to see the day when the Israeli government is asking Jews for Jesus to help minister to the needs of the people. But that's really some of what's been happening in these past number of months. So yes, light is shining in the darkness. We're seeing more openness to the gospel than ever before. Dr. Parrott asked me to reflect on this time of COVID and what we may see God teaching us through it. And I wanted to bring a particular perspective that comes right out of this past few weeks, because you may or may not know this, but Jewish people this past week have been celebrating the Feast of Passover. And Passover is the story of God's deliverance of the Jewish people from bondage and slavery in Egypt thousands of years ago. And the interesting thing is that God provided that deliverance through plague. The Bible uses the word plague over 100 times, and we often think of plague as just a disease. But of course, in the Bible, plagues are not just about illness and sickness as we've had this past year, but you can have natural disasters, upheavals like the sun turning dark and locust infestation. But oftentimes it is through plagues that God accomplishes his purpose. And because he's the creator of the universe, he's not taken off guard when plague hits. So we look at plagues and our own current crisis through the lens of Scripture. And for Jewish people, the deliverance from bondage and slavery in Egypt thousands of years ago came about as a result of a plague. We read about this in Exodus chapter 12. God had promised to deliver the Jewish people from slavery, and so he raised up Moses to go to the Pharaoh of Egypt and say, "Pharaoh, let my people go." But Pharaoh wasn't exactly willing to listen. And so God had to persuade Pharaoh to listen. How did he do it? God can be very persuasive when he wants to. And he persuaded Pharaoh to listen to Moses by sending a series of plagues on the land of Egypt. You remember the story. There were 10 plagues in all. Now, the Jewish people were living in a section of Egypt called Goshen, and they were automatically exempt from the first 9 of those 10 plagues. For example, the Bible tells us when darkness fell across the land of Egypt as a plague from the Lord, there was nevertheless light in Goshen where the Israelites were dwelling. Or when God struck the cattle of the Egyptians with a plague, the cattle of the Israelites were spared. But that was not the case with the 10th plague, the worst plague, the death of the firstborn. In order that that plague should not fall upon the children of Israel there in Egypt, God commanded them to take a yearling male lamb without spot, without blemish, without any broken bone. We were to take that lamb and to sacrifice it. And then we were to take the blood and to sprinkle it on the top lintel and the 2 side posts of the doorposts of our houses. And when that plague of death passed through the land of Egypt, every home that had that blood on the doorpost, death was forced to pass over. And so as a result of that, Israel was delivered, freed from bondage and slavery in Egypt. And throughout history of the Jewish people, God commanded that we continue to commemorate this great deliverance. And so we have the Passover Seder, a meal that's celebrated. And as we celebrated, there were various symbols and traditions that were added to the observance to remind us of that first Passover back in the land of Egypt. So that by the time Jesus and his disciples were celebrating the Passover, most of what we do today was already incorporated into that Passover observance. And of course, the most significant Passover that Jesus celebrated was that one in the upper room. The Last Supper was a Passover. So then we can see how much more significant this Passover comes to be for us who are followers of Jesus in light of all that he said and did on that night he was betrayed. And one of the aspects of the development of Passover was this, the cup. And of course, the cup is a symbol of fullness of joy. And we actually drink from this cup 4 times throughout the Passover. The first time we drink, it is called the cup of sanctification. And when Jesus celebrated the Passover, he took this cup and he said, "This cup is with great desire that I have desired to eat this Passover with you, but I tell you truly, I will not partake of the fruit of the vine again until I drink it anew in the kingdom of God." But the second time we take from the cup, it is called the cup of plagues. And though the cup is a symbol of the fullness of joy, what we do is we take our finger and we dip it into the cup and drop a drop on the plate in front of us. 1 drop for each one of the plagues God visited on the land of Egypt. A full cup is a symbol of joy. We symbolically lessen our joy as we remember the suffering of the Egyptians. We remember the blood, the hail, the locusts, the boils, the cattle disease, the darkness, the death. 9 times Pharaoh hardened his heart, and each time God sent a plague on the land of Egypt. But the 10th plague was the worst of all. It was the death of the firstborn. Now, God told the children of Israel to take the blood of that sacrificed lamb in a basin, to go outside of their homes and apply that blood to the doorposts, putting it on the top lintel and the 2 side posts of their homes. The blood of the lamb on the top lintel and the 2 side posts, making the sign of a cross with the blood of the lamb on that doorpost. That night, death flew through the land of Egypt. There was weeping and wailing as never before, till Pharaoh cried out, "Let them go, or I'll die." But everywhere that the blood of the lamb was on the top lintel and the 2 side posts, the plague of death passed over that house. And so redemption came that night to the children of Israel in the land of Egypt. Now, because I believe in Jesus as my Messiah, and because I have by faith applied the blood of his sacrifice to the doorpost of my heart, when death comes to visit me, death is going to pass over me also. because I have eternal life. Praise God for that. And I think it's very important for us as we are in this season of plague to remember that we need not fear death, those of us who trusted in Jesus. He is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And because of that, we have also a message of hope to bring. There have been over a half a million people who have died in the United States of America alone. And death has been all around us. But the second death, the death that is eternal, is the worst death. And that is the one to fear the most. And because we know Jesus, because we have the Lamb of God, we can point to him and we can bring hope into a dark world. And so my prayer for you, my brothers and sisters there at Belhaven, is that you have indeed put your hope and trust in the Lamb of God who allows us to pass over from death into life eternal. And secondly, my hope is that you will be able to bring this same message to your friends, to your family, to Jewish people that you might know. Because all of us in a time of plague need to know of the hope of eternal life that is found only in Jesus, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Let's pray. Almighty and everlasting God, we thank you that you are indeed the one who, through whom we can pass over from death into life eternal. And during a time of plague all around the world, this message of gospel hope should give us even greater cause to rejoice, even in the midst of the darkness that surrounds us. Lord, I pray that not only would we rejoice, but that we would bring the joy and the hope that we have in the Lamb of God, that all who trust in him can pass over from death into life eternal. Renew our confidence and hope in this message, and may the Lamb of God shine brightly in our hearts in this season. We pray B'Shem Yeshua, in the name of Jesus. Amen. God bless you.
Is it I?